Welcome to St. Andrew's Sunday morning worship. We're glad that you joined us this morning. We're going to begin in-person worship on the 13th of September, and if you'd like to join us, send me an email at frjimbo@msn.com, because we're going to have reservations to keep everybody socially distanced and safe, and so we'll get you a reservation. Also, we send out an email each week to let you know what's going on. If you don't get the email, then I encourage you to also contact me at that same email address. And you can look on our website at www.pumpkinchurch.com. We begin our worship on page 323 in your Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ saith: Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it: Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. Let us pray. Grant, O Lord, we pray thee, to trust in thee with all our heart, seeing that thou dost always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so thou dost not forsake those who make their boast of thy mercy. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and pour it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until the morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as perpetual ordinance." The word of the Lord. Psalm 149. Hallelujah! Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing his praise in the congregation of the faithful. Let Israel rejoice in his Maker. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their King. Let them praise his name in the dance. Let them sing praise to him with timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people and adorns the poor with victory. Let the faithful rejoice in triumph. Let them be joyful on their beds. Let the praises of God be in their throat and a two-edged sword in their hand, to wreak vengeance on the nations and punishment on the peoples, to bind their kings in chains and their nobles with links of iron, to inflict on them the judgment decreed. This is glory for all his faithful people. Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Jesus said, "If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church, and if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they asked, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in the midst of them." The Gospel of the Lord. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Sometimes a priest must preach on a gospel reading that he or she finds troublesome. Today's reading is one I find quite troublesome and the source of much mischief. The passage begins with a process for handling the situation where one member of the church sins against another. The aggrieved party tries to resolve the issue by himself, and if that fails, then with the help of a witness. And if that fails, with the help of the church. But if that fails, the accused sinner is to be shunned, treated as one would treat a Gentile or a tax collector. This passage is the basis for the cruel practice of shunning, through which a church community casts someone out, turning their backs on that person completely, refusing them aid in time of need. Jesus, on the other hand, taught forgiveness of those who sin against us. We ask God to forgive us as we forgive those who sin against us whenever we say the Lord's Prayer. Moreover, Jesus himself hung out with tax collectors and called one of them to be his disciple. He did not shun them. Jesus also interacted compassionately with non-Jews, as in the case of the woman at the well, or the centurion whose servant Jesus healed, or the Moabite woman we heard about in a recent gospel. The early church primarily consisted of Gentiles rather than Jews. This passage was probably inserted into the Gospel of Matthew as a means of handling heretics. The sin in question was probably not so much sinning against a church member, but getting at odds with the church leader. Shape up or ship out. The reading also tells us that whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and when a couple of us can agree that when we want God to do something, God has to do it. This makes God our servant, someone who has to obey us, not a teaching that seems consistent with the Christian message. We have all encountered gospel passages with which we disagree, or which we realize contradict other Bible passages, or perhaps we just don't understand. So what do we do about that? What do I do about that as a priest of the church? There are several ways I could deal with some passage in the Bible I find problematic. First, I could try to interpret the passage in a way that avoids the problem. Perhaps Jesus was speaking tongue-in-cheek, and I should read the passage as sarcasm. Or perhaps the passage was not something that Jesus said at all. It was added later by someone to address a particular conflict in a church and was to be applied in that particular limited circumstance. In other words, I could try my best to find a way to interpret the passage so that it ceases to be a problem. Or I could recognize that the problem passage contradicts other passages that are clear and that seem consistent with my understanding of Jesus' message of love. Then I will accept the passages I like and ignore the one that seems to contradict them. Or I could just say, I don't understand the problem passage at all, and there are plenty of passages that I think I do understand, so I don't really have to understand them all. No, I do not believe that God is going to have me win the Powerball lottery because I have the prayer team agree that I ought to win it. I do not believe that if we all agree that the moon is made of cheddar cheese, that God will remake the moon according to our agreement. What I do believe is that we must treat the Bible with great respect and read it prayerfully with an open heart and with an open mind, asking the Spirit to speak to us through the words we hear or the words we read. Your interpretation of a Bible passage may not be my interpretation. I may find a passage troublesome that speaks to you quite plainly. The Bible is a means through which the Spirit may speak to us, or the Spirit may remain silent, or the Spirit may even tell us that a passage is not one that we should apply in our own lives. The Episcopal Church states that the Bible contains all things necessary for salvation, but it does not spell out what those necessary things are. And those things that are necessary for salvation are included with a lot that certainly is not necessary for salvation, and that quite frankly can even be a hindrance to a healthy spiritual life. Maybe you got something out of today's reading that was helpful to you. The one statement in the reading I love and I've always found helpful is that where two or three are gathered together in Jesus' name, Jesus is there together with them. But if those two or three all agree that I should win the lottery, I'm not going to run out and buy a ticket. So if you read the Bible and find parts of it troublesome, know that I have the same problem. And I'm not concerned about it because I do not place my faith in a book, but a person, Jesus Christ. In heaven, we will not need the Bible. The Bible is meant to be a spiritual aid, not an end in itself. Therefore, use and respect the Bible as a spiritual aid, but do not treat it as an end in itself. Do not put a burden on the Bible that both it and you cannot bear. It is Jesus who is the way, the truth, and the life. Let love always be our primary guide as we seek to grow ever more into the life and into the grace of God. Amen.
The Nicene Creed is found on page 326 in your prayer book. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. For all people in their daily life and work, for our families, friends and neighbors, and for those who are alone, for this community, the nation, and the world, for all who work for justice, freedom, and peace, for the just and proper use of your creation, for the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression, for Olga, Ron, Kathy, Shay, for small businesses that are struggling, those who are unable to vote or afraid their vote won't count, for St. Michael's Episcopal Church in Lake Charles, and for all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble, for those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy, for the peace and unity of the Church of God, for all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth, for all bishops and other ministers, for all who serve God in his church. Guide us, Heavenly Father, to live as a loving family with all the peoples of the world. We especially ask for protection for Christians who are suffering persecution and threats this day as they serve you. Help us to heal the divisions and enmity in our nation so we may share respect and inclusion for all. Many are suffering due to the pandemic of COVID. We ask you comfort and heal those who are ill, and protect their families and loved ones. Shield all those who work to provide for our needs and health every day, especially in this time of danger to exposure of illness. Lead those who will teach our children to a place of peace so they can share their gifts with their students with ease. Guide the parents of school children to calm decisions about their children and school at the beginning of the academic year. Grant relief and comfort for all those who have suffered loss from Hurricane Laura. Help us support those friends and families now and in the months to come. As we near the anniversary of 9/11, we offer thanksgiving for all of the first responders who protect us and our nation, especially those who gave their lives in service to our communities or suffer life-changing injuries. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, hear us, Lord, for your mercy is great. We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. For Jenny Hollis, David Eshelman, Pat Johnson, Christine Liberatore, Jeff Brown, Melly Bratcher, Bobby Hurd, Pat DeLucia, Mary Roker, Philip Mabry, and Mark Sines, who celebrate their birthday this week, and for James and Kathleen Wright, Keith and Jack Forsyth, and John and Karen Saxon, who celebrate their anniversaries this week. We will exalt you, O God, our King, and praise your name forever and ever. We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them, who put their trust in you.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I have climbed highest mountains.
You will join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost rest on you this day and remain with you always. Amen.